the Mike Calta Show. It's 1025 The Bone, 727-579-1025 or 800-771-1025. Last night, I want to thank Third Leg Greg Wolf, who is the in-game announcer. You know Greg?
Yeah.
He made it so they put a nice announcement on the scoreboard for my son, who scored a goal and was at the game with his team last night.
Oh, nice.
Yeah, it was pretty cool. That's a cool thing. I can't imagine if my son's so used to that stuff. He's like, oh, it was cool. But I'd be like, oh, my God. Can you imagine?
Yeah.
When we were kids, that old digital, those little digital dots and lines said our names on the scoreboard. Yeah, it's up on the Instagram. It was pretty cool. They did a nice little thing.
It's on yours.
I put it on the story of our other one, too, because I wanted to say thank you to the Lightning. The Lightning won last night in a shootout, which is the scariest way to watch your team when it comes down to the very end.
I love shootouts.
I love them, but, you know, even in soccer, watching that stuff is great, but it's nerve-wracking.
Yeah, I used to love, because growing up playing soccer, I used to love shootouts, and I used to love being in the shootout. I was like, I got this.
Yeah.
I'm definitely going to do
pressure.
This.
I can't hit.
Oh, man, I used to take all the penalty kicks. We had our next-door neighbor who played soccer as well. They had a goal in their backyard, full-size goal, and we used to play over there all the time, and I would just be out there kicking goals. Upper right-hand corner, upper right-hand corner. The goalie can't get it.
So I put it over his head. What are you going to do?
Yeah.
And the other thing is, I want to offer, condolences to our radio friends who are getting blown out at iHeart everywhere.
That's crazy, right?
Yeah. I don't know who and I don't know what, but I heard over a dozen folks in the Tampa Bay area lost their jobs. And it was, of all people, it was Hoppy who put it on his Facebook yesterday. Hoppy said, I don't get people celebrating when other people in the same profession lose their jobs. I'm with you, Hoppy. I'm with you 100%.
Yeah.
It's like you forgot what it was like when you got fired, and you're worried, and you're saying, what the hell am I going to do now? I don't know where to, what am I going to work? Because some of these people were probably in the very beginning of their career. Some of them may have been in the middle. Some of them may be, this is the end for them. And this is a very sad and scary time, and it just shows you that the changes that are being made aren't always good for everybody, and I feel bad for these people, but hopefully, you know, the people who really love radio and want to stay in it will keep going and find someplace else to work.
So Randy Allen hit me up last night on text, and, you know, you picked Mo as your bone person.
Yes.
That you thought would be out. Well, Mo had posted this, and this is what Randy sent to me. No one stays in radio because they love it. You love it before you know it. You stay in because it's a calling, blah, blah, blah. Anyways, it says it sucks. If you go show up and your key card doesn't work anymore. And so Randy's like, oh, boy, points for Mike. And I go, uh-oh. And he goes, first to go. And I go, no, that's only counts for death.
Yeah.
Whatever this and that. I go, his card might just be messed up. We don't know. And he's like, oh, we'll see. And then Mo posted, not about me. iHeart had a wrecking ball today. Blah, 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 this and that. And I go, there you go.
Yeah.
Let's not start giving Mike points just yet.
No. And no, by the way, they never do that. The only way you're coming to work and your key card doesn't work is if you did something insane the day before.
You threatened the place.
If you're getting fired, they're not just locking you out in the morning.
Or if they just totally sold the company. What was the place where they showed up and that's how they found out? They were like, yeah, they sold it.
It was a restaurant, wasn't it?
I think
something
so.
Like that. This corporation doesn't work that way. I know there's going to be a day where, and I know it's going to come at an odd time where we'll be still number one and still huge, but something will change and they'll bring in the office and they'll go on a Friday after the show and say, corporate says you make too much money, or they do this and that and the other thing.
Robot overlords say that we should be doing this instead.
Real, yeah.
Right. So that's AI just how this business is. I've been fortunate where I've only been fired twice, both from the same radio station and the same radio company. And every other time has been a positive move for me. And there really haven't been that many moves. I mean, I'm here almost 14 years.
I don't want to jinx it. Knock on wood. I have never been fired. I have only worked at 3 radio stations. This is the 3rd one that I worked for. I have been here 13 years, and in June, I will be in radio for 20 years.
Woo, good
that's
for
crazy.
You.
Isn't that weird? Absolutely crazy.
How is that? I mean, I'm 28 years old. How is that possible?
Well, like, for Spanish and myself, this is both our first radio jobs. Like, he had a school.
And you make more than he does already.
Oh.
Listen, Spanish makes way more than I do. Mm. But this is both our first radio jobs. I've never known what it's like to put together a demo or, like, actually go seek. I literally showed up. I sent a, or someone sent a bikini picture of me to Mike. Mm-hmm. He said, send her in. I came in and they were like, as long as you're willing to work for free and do what we tell you.
Yeah. And, well, like most slaves.
Yeah. And here I am. And it's just like, I'm so scared.
It's funny because I was fired and then CBS was like, we'll send over a demo. And I went, you gotta be kidding me. I worked in this market for 10 years and I gotta send you a demo. You know what I do? Like, I was like so annoyed by that. But I didn't know how to do it. I mean, I knew how to do it, but I didn't have, I had to go start finding material and all that.
Yeah. I did it and it became a passion. Like, I love putting together a demo. I love doing that stuff.
And you know what? That's something that you could do after, like, when you're retired or stuff. There's people that will pay for you to do that for them.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? And that's something that'd be something easy that you could do from home and stuff. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Spanish is ready.
$1,000 to make my demo.
Oh man, that
$1,500 if you could get it to me by the end of the month.
That is way more.
$2,000
All right.
That is way more than I would have charged you. So yes, $1,500
by the end of the month. Yeah.
Gio, you've been fired a bunch.
Oh yeah. Gio, you've worked at 19 different places.
The last time iHeart had their big firing, like they fired like 1,000 people, I got fired.
Oh really?
I was part of that. Yeah.
And what did they say to you? Were you dislocated?
Oh, yeah. Dislocated wasn't the word at the time, but I remember he's like, yeah, we had did the budgets. I know you've noticed a lot of changes that are happening company-wide. We did the budgets, and you're no longer a part of it. So,
wow.
Yeah.
We did not figure you into the next year's budget.
Yeah.
That's awful.
How many different shows have you worked for?
Oh, just on this. I've worked them all on this station.
He really has.
Except Roger and JP, yeah.
You were at 97X.
Yeah.
They brought you over here to what? What was the first show?
I worked with Spice.
Then?
Drew.
Then
Mo and Johnny.
Then
just Mo.
Then
SBK.
Then here.
And then here.
Yeah. We poached you.
Yeah.
Okay. Where are you going next?
I got a couple feelers out.
Yeah.
You worked in Tallahassee, then you worked in Sarasota, right?
Yeah, I was in Tallahassee, and there I was on three different stations.
In Tallahassee?
Yeah. I started on sports. Or no, I actually started in country, then went to sports, then back to country, then back to sports, then to the rock station, and then to Sarasota.
You and Galvin are the only ones in this room who've ever hot-jocked the song before.
Yeah. I did it for several years.
I might be awful at that.
Yeah.
You'd be surprised. It's easy. For college radio. But
just throw in killer, killer rock and roll every once in a while.
Yeah.
People will get it.
I listen to those guys like on Satellite who do it after every song. They have to come up with something witty to say. And I don't know what I would do. Like the MTV guys we were talking about before was great because they got, you know, 30 years to talk about.
Yeah, I got to tell you, I listen to radio and I hear people do that and I cringe because there's so many. And I know that they're trying and I get it. And listen, there was stuff that I did that I cringe at now.
Yeah.
But you just go, maybe just intro the song and not try and be, you know.
Well, now it's even more fake than it used to be because you'll hear people say, you know, some DJs, even locally here in town, will be like, hey, shout out to Bill and Newport Richie. You got that song coming up for you next. Shut up, dude. Yeah, you're not in the studio.
Yeah. Bill never called.
Yeah, there's no request. Nobody's reading emails for song requests.
You live in Louisville.
Yeah, you suck.
What, what?
Aaron says he knows what the company was that shut the doors and the people didn't know.
Oh, what was it, Aaron?
It was Montgomery Ward's. Everybody showed up and everything was locked down.
Well, that's not what we were talking about, but that probably happened. But here we're talking about something more recent. It was a restaurant that closed down.
Oh.
And but I'm sure that's happened plenty of times, though. Thank you, sir. I appreciate the call. Before we bring Chico in.
Galvin in the morning.
I have to disagree with that. It's not gay for guys to have cats.
Okay.
I had three of them. My cats used to get high with me. So
brother.
I had one. He was a tiger striped cat, and he used to love to get high. Sit on the arm of the chair while we smoke weed.
That doesn't help your argument whenever you're a person that gets your cats high. That blows your credibility.
That's another thing that is absolutely amazing.
This was the second thing I sent you. That was the second one, though.
Checks. Oh, I know.
Look how cute and, you know, she's like 19.
And hot.
Yeah. I think I dated her. You know,
did she grow up on a farm?
Because she seems to like the animals.
Oh,
Who is that?
That was Murph.
Oh, was it really?
Yeah, who's dead now.
I know. What did you do? We both have partners who died.
Yeah.
We're getting old. Not Gio. What is your name? Spanish. Please go get Chicone and bring him in here. Well, anyway, I wanted to mention those people and and encourage them to look for jobs elsewhere. That's how radio is. Congratulations. You're now officially in radio.
Oof.
Once you've been fired.
That's rough.
Hope you didn't have a house.
Good luck.
That's what you want to see. Let me look at this guy. Oh, look at you. You're still in such good shape, aren't you?
Well, I try.
Yeah, you do. How often do you... By the way, ladies and gentlemen, your former Tampa Bay Lightning tough guy, ENRICO CHICONE, is here with us.
Good to be here. Thanks, man.
Yeah, man. It's great to see you.
The whole gang. I hear you guys a lot, but...
Have you never met anybody? Have you ever met Calvin?
No.
Sorry, that's Calvin. Don't curse. We're live on the air. That's Spanish. That's Carmen.
Yeah, Carmen.
Yeah. You've never been in the studio here before?
Never.
Oh, my God.
I tried to come
we're very popular.
Tampa. We go to dinner every night, though,
when
I come here, though.
That works out.
Yeah, once a night.
Okay, so Chico is, let me guess and tell me if I'm right. You were on the Blackhawks, and you went from the Blackhawks to Tampa.
No.
Where did you come from?
I started with the Minnesota North Stars.
Right.
They don't exist anymore, so it makes me pretty old.
Yeah.
Then I went to Washington.
The Capitals?
Capitals. Okay. Then I came here. The Tampa.
When were you in Chicago?
After Tampa.
Oh.
After Tampa. The year they went to the... finally, we made the playoffs.
Right.
And I got traded deadline.
Okay. Chicago. Right. And then you came back here.
Then I came back after 2 years, 2.5 years. Yeah.
Okay.
They brought me back.
All right. That makes a lot of sense. And now, it's interesting because a couple of years ago, 5 years ago to be exact, you were here and your son was here.
Yeah.
How old is he now?
He's 21 now.
Okay. So he was like 16 when he was here last time.
Yeah.
And you said, this is something that I always ask people, I always like, especially when they're fathers and sons, I always go, when did your son realize that you're cool? You know what I mean? like I always want to know, like, when your kid kicks in. And last time you were here, you said your son would watch your videos on YouTube and he'd go, oh, all you do is fight?
Exactly.
Like, meanwhile, we're all like fans and we're like, fight, Chico, fight. And he's like, oh, all you do is fight.
But you know what? That pained me. Pained me when he saw that, you know, because when I retired, he was 2 years old, so he never really saw me play with Montreal at the end with Montreal Canadiens. Exactly.
Yeah.
It sucks because he, one time, all his buddies are all excited. Dad. Oh, ENRICO, your dad. And he goes, my dad's not a hockey player. He only fights.
Oh.
And he said that one day, dad, you don't play hockey. You just fought.
I'm like,
oh, my God. That just broke my heart because the only thing you see on YouTube, it's all fights.
Right. Well, I mean.
But I scored some goals.
Yeah. You know, you were a good player. And also, the other thing is that we didn't have the kind of footage available back then like we do now. Everything's immediately available on the internet.
See what you're showing? Just fights.
There's Chico, the fights.
Chico, you should embrace this now. I mean, if you were my father, I'd be like, oh, my father's a badass.
Yeah.
Your son knows that now. Now that he's older, I bet he gets it.
Yeah, well, I think he does because it's the way I was doing it. It's not because I was doing it for fun.
No.
It's because I was taking care of somebody, taking care of my teammates. And that's what I do now in my new job. But that kind of hurt me when I got into politics.
Oh, that you were a fighter?
They use that against me, you know?
So,
because they think that we're all stupid because we're hockey players. We fight. We're
a goon.
Bullying everybody on the ice. Well, they think that we do the same thing off the ice, which is not.
And they don't understand. And it took me a while to really understand that you're fighting for a purpose. You're not fighting just because you bumped into a guy and you don't like each other. Something either happened to one of your other players. Like, sometimes you'll go out after a guy because he did something to one of your star players or something like that.
Exactly.
Or sometimes you just need to get under their skin, kind of throw them off a little bit, and that's part of what hockey is.
Exactly. Well, it used to be a part of that. Now, it's not that anymore because we don't... These type of players that I was back then, they tend to get them out of the game. They don't use them anymore because they try to get the violence down in the NHL, which is okay because now we know what's going on with concussions and everything, so we have to be careful. But when I used to go out and fight, it's because somebody, you know, hit Bradley or Hamerlick, or sometimes we were losing the game 3-1, 4-1 at the end. So we try to mix it up, you know, try to make
spark
your players make your players feel stronger, you know, more powerful. So that was a part of the game, but. If you ask me if I liked to fight, I didn't like to fight. Nobody likes to get punched in the face and broke his nose.
Sometimes I think you like to fight. After it was over, I've seen you walk to the locker room before.
The sad thing and the scariest thing is that when I fought, I don't remember that time I was fighting.
Yeah.
I'd wake up after.
Oh, really?
And sometimes guys would go, oh, my God, Chico, what'd you do? I'm like, what did I do? You know, because you kind of lose it.
Your adrenaline
you
kicks in
lose
so
it.
Hard.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So you're in survival mode.
Do you have one that you look back on that you love the most? Or a rivalry?
You know what? The rivalry, well, I like the Detroit Red Wings rivalry. Uh-huh. You know, we had a fight one time with Jamie Pusher. That's a funny story because Jamie Pusher used to be a scout for the Lightning,
right,
at the end of his career. And you know, sometimes you get traumatized, uh-huh, you know, with what happens in the past. You know, I know there's one of my teachers in fifth grade. She traumatized me so much that when I went to the school to do a conference like 30 years later, I kind of froze in front of her because she took me back to when I was 11 years old.
Yeah.
She used to be really tough on me.
Wouldn't it be great if Chico punched her?
Come on now. Oh, okay. So I saw Jamie in the press box, you know, that's a while back. And when he saw me, he put his eyes down, you know, and because I kicked his butt pretty badly.
Right.
And he kind of got intimidated and he put his eyes down and he came all red and he kind of went avoided me. So I'm like, come on, man. It's like, it's been 15 years. So I went to him and I started talking to him. Hey, Gene, what's going on? So he kind of felt better. But at first, he was like kind of intimidated.
Well, you don't
still
know. You know, he doesn't know if you're going to have any angry feelings towards him either, you know?
Well, I kicked his butt. I mean, I'm not going to have feelings.
Got it all out.
Exactly. I don't know. I hate people for a long time.
You do? I don't. I don't.
People always say it's not good for you. I go, it's working for me pretty good.
No, I don't, because people tend to tell me, well, don't forget what he did to you.
Yeah.
You can't go back there. I'm like, come on, man. Give the guy another chance. Yeah. And that person another
chance. Wow, look at you, the big softy now.
I've always been a softy. What are you talking about? You know me for 25 years.
I know.
You know I'm a softy.
I know. It's hard to think. I love to watch. I love to show my son videos of you fighting and stuff. But
you got to stop doing that, man.
No, because, listen, because they need to know. They need to know that that's what hockey was like before, yeah, and that there were very important guys on the teams that were a part of that. It's not that you're just a bruiser, but that's what helps make other players successful. I mean, Wayne Gretzky never got in a fight in his life, but people wanted to fight him. But it was guys like you who went out there and kept him protected. Yeah.
But it's sad now because now today we kind of know the repercussion of fighting is. We know with concussions. And, you know, you got guys that commit suicide that I played with and against. Guys that live in the woods now because of a CTE problems.
There was a documentary, and I can't remember the name of the player.
Rob Murphy.
Was that the one where he said he hated going out and fighting? That he hated it? That he had to do it a lot of times?
That's not that documentary. I know what you're talking about.
Murphy's the one who lives in the woods, right?
But Rob Murphy lives in the woods.
Yeah, he's got probably. Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
There was
too.
A guy who was he was mainly fighter out there, and he said, "You don't understand." He goes, "I would get stomach
exactly
aches. Like I would get so upset about it because he knew he had to go out there and fight, and he didn't want to do it, but he was good at it, and that was his role." And he goes, "I hated it so much." And a lot of people think these guys go out there and they love it. No, that's all they want to do is fight.
The wheel is turning, you know. Yeah. The wheel is turning, and you get older, then you get these new guys coming in, you know, new ways of training. They're bigger. They're stronger, and you're at the end, you're 30 years old in hockey, and 30 years old, you're old.
Oh yeah,
I mean, I've been
your
there for 10 years.
60 now. Yeah,
I couldn't sleep in the afternoon. You know, I had ulcers. You know, I had a hard time eating because I knew that young buck was coming after me just to give himself a name. So, it's tough, man. It's tougher mentally than physically. I'm Canadian, man. I'm Canadian.
Not gonna work.
We don't have guns in Canada.
I mean, on the ice, just if you know a guy's coming at you, just be prepared.
Get a sniper ready.
Enrico Chicone is here with us. I still go to a lot of games. I still see 39 Chicone jerseys.
I know.
Yeah, those are great. Number 39, not only 39. I see jerseys. That's got to make you feel good.
Yeah, it makes me feel good when, you know, somebody sends me a picture on Twitter, on Instagram. Hey, Chico, look at this. You know, that kind of melts my heart a little bit because you try to do something and leave a mark, you know, and that's what I told my son yesterday. We were at the game yesterday, actually. Uh-huh. We saw that thing with your son.
Oh, yeah.
How much did that cost you?
Millions.
That's great. I told my son, you know, I said, you know, where you're sitting right now, you know, dad took the shovel, you know, and the first, you know, piece of earth.
And moved it.
And moved it. You know, I did that with Phil Esposito.
Esposito,
And Roman Emmerich. So I said, you know what? Dad built that. I said, Vinnie LeCavalier paid for it.
Right.
But Chico built it.
That's awesome.
Can I ask you, this is going to be a tough question to ask you because they retired St. Louis' number first before Vinny, and I didn't agree with that. What do you think about that?
Well, you know what? At the time, I think St. Louis was retired. You know, I think it was just
only a year
matter,
apart.
Yeah, but I think it's just a matter of timing. You know, you wanted to do something, especially with it's a franchise like the Lightning. They have no numbers retired.
Right.
You know, you tell me they had to wait for Vinny to retire. You don't know when Vinny's going to retire.
We kind of had an idea. I mean, Vinny ended his career by going to another team to play for the playoffs. So you knew it was coming.
Yeah.
I don't know. I just think that really from the moment that kid came here, they put this whole organization on his shoulders. And he carried it very well and would have stayed here forever and lives here now. And I believe, like you said, paid for that place.
Yeah.
So I you know, not that it was disrespectful, but St. Louis certainly deserves to be up there as well. Mm. I just think they should have held out for Vinny. I was just curious to see what everybody else thought.
I was just waiting for that statue of Vinny.
Yeah.
You know,
I told St. Louis.
Something's got to happen because he's the man here.
You're right.
You know,
I told St. Louis no statue for you because it was a tiny little statue. He did not find it as funny as you are. We had a great interview.
Not.
We had a great interview with him, and I threw that out at the end, and he just went silent. And I was like, "Well, okay, good luck, good talking
to
you."
Go.
Yeah,
yeah. Well, you know, that was one of the issues with him. I mean, he's from Laval, close to where I live, from Quebec, and they always told him he was too small, he wouldn't make it. And when I'm at the end of my career, he was trying to make it, come in with the Calgary Flames, and he couldn't make it because back then it used to be like a belligerent game, big game, strong guys, a lot of holding, and he still made it. When he came to Tampa, so that's why there was something that followed him.
And not only made it, but became such a great player. Yeah.
Exactly.
And then, you know, we were real lucky. I mean, once that turn went into that new generation of players, and you had Vinny, and you had Brad Richards, and you had, I mean, Fedotenko came over here. All these good guys that came here and played with this team. And then the guys before that, Gratton and Weimer, and we've always had a fun group of guys that played here.
Yeah. No, it was good, but and there was two mentalities also.
Yeah.
You know, as far as you went in time, well, guys got to be a little bit more serious. You know, they didn't go out as much, and, you know, they trained more, the way they were training, the way they were eating. You know, in my days, we used to go out, have a good time, you know, have a few beers, and you know, we didn't watch what we ate all the time.
It didn't exist. Nutrition, you know, really didn't exist like that for
it
for
did
you guys.
But not at this, not like now. Not,
no,
now they're,
now
they're
doing macros and counting
God, they weigh their food and everything, and they count the percentage of protein and fat they eat.
That's like, you know, you look at the 70s baseball players and stuff, they look like they're just it's a math teacher. Baseball, you know, it's so weird.
You know, we went to the restaurant Eddie V's Sunday night.
Yeah,
can we say Eddie V's?
Yeah, of course. Okay. They're great.
Well, they owe you what, $50 now?
No. You've given me enough.
And you know, the LA Kings were there.
Yeah.
And it's funny because Galvin always, when they used to come out, his son and Pete's son, they can name them.
It was amazing.
Oh, yeah.
They all looked exactly the same to me. Everyone, they were all wearing black on black with baseball hats. And every guy that walked out, except for Dowdy, who I knew, looked the same. And they were like, no, that's this guy.
That's Brown. I'm like, oh my God, even though I was in the game. And 2 years ago, I had a sports, the radio sports show in Montreal, number one sports show. And you know, and you see these kids, and I'm like, then I talked to Pete and Mike. I said, what happened to their shoulders?
Yeah.
These guys have no shoulders. I mean, they're so skinny.
Yep.
I'm like, what's going on? These guys would have got killed in our days. But I saw the game yesterday. You know, you see how they play. They don't hate each other anymore.
No.
It's all about speed. It's all about speed and finesse.
It is all about speed. Yeah. When Braden Point first got here and that kid used to get that puck, I never seen anybody move so fast.
Yeah.
It was amazing. I love the shootout at the end.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like the anxiety. If you're a goalie, I don't know how you get through that mentally.
I know.
The pressure is on you. You could screw it up for everybody right there.
I know it's tough, but, you know, this is the part of the game that I don't like. Actually, because I've always had the warrior mentality is that when you win a game, it's because you left everything on the ice.
Right.
You know, and to win a game with a shootout, you know, 3-on-3 at the end in a shootout.
But what do you do? You leave it at a tie?
Yeah, leave it at ties.
The fans want to see a shootout.
Well, exactly. The fans, they want to see, you know, they want to see a show, a spectacle. That's okay. They pay the money, but
you don't feel so bad if your team loses at a shootout because you're like, well, what are you going to do?
Well, that's the other thing. You lose a shootout and you still get a point. What is that?
Because
you win a point because you lost.
Well, you really tied.
No, you lost.
Oh.
You lost. You're in the lost column. So that's not the right way to do it.
Who's the best goalie you played with?
The best goalie again? Well, play with or against?
Played with, like on your team.
Well, Eddie Belfort.
Yeah,
he was good. He
because
was
you're good. You're the. I mean, that is easily your way to success. I mean, that, you know, yeah. Every team wants a.
Of course.
You know,
Darren Pupo was great too.
Was he?
Oh, Darren was good.
I don't remember. Like, I see him more now than I did when he played.
Yeah.
I didn't really. It's weird because I grew up in the Northeast, but wasn't really a hockey fan until I came here.
Darren
was
so
into
player.
Baseball and football.
That guy was he was a silent genius.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. He didn't speak much, but when he spoke, you know, everybody listened because just the stuff he used to get out. You know, he's an engineer. You know that? Eh?
No, I didn't know that.
Yeah, he's an engineer. He's a very smart guy, and I remember somehow you sitting right beside me, and guys would say stuff about the water rising, and you know, and then he was just shake his head. Like, saying, so I'm like, what's going on, Poops? Go, that's impossible because of this and that, and then he lost me.
He was so smart.
But he was a good goalie.
I see him a lot now at charity events and stuff, and he seems like a really nice guy. The one thing that I remember about Pupa is, I don't think you were here anymore, but I went into goal against the Lightning player. It was against Gratton, Dino, Corey Schwab was the goalie at the time, or a backup goalie or whatever, and it was somebody else. Anyway, but I had to wear Pupa's helmet because it was the only one that fit my big head.
I know.
He had a
big head.
Yeah, he did. I was like, oh, thank God there's another giant-headed man on this team. ENRICO CHICONE is here with us. CHICONE left hockey in what year?
2000, 2001.
Okay, and then went into broadcasting immediately?
Right away. Yeah,
and
right away.
Good at it.
Right away.
Yeah.
I did 18 TV. Years of TV. I did the Olympics. I was in Pyeongchang in 2018.
Oh, really?
I did for CBC in French, so I did all that. And I did two Olympics. I did pretty much everything between the benches, you know, during NHL games.
You love that?
I loved it.
Yeah.
I mean, you're back in the game.
Right.
And you know you're not going to get hurt. You're not going to get penalties.
But you can tell on the ice. Man, right.
It's beautiful. So I did that for 18 years, and then I just stumbled and got into politics.
Yeah, before we get into politics, I have one more question. And I asked who Callahan was in here last. When you're on the ice, how much can you see the crowd?
Well, I didn't really see the crowd.
I asked Callahan, I go, can you see a hot girl in the third row? He's like, absolutely. I'm like, can you see a guy giving you the finger in the fourth row? He's like, absolutely.
Well, you know what? Callahan was a good player.
Yeah.
You know, I was a okay player. Uh-huh. So I had to be concentrated.
On the ice.
On the ice for everything, you know, because when you get the tap on the shoulder, you got to go and you got to get ready and you got to be, you can't get distracted. Right. Yeah, I didn't have the, how can I say that, the liberty to be distracted.
Gotcha. You know?
So I didn't hear the crowd. I didn't see the crowd. But
what about when you're in the penalty box? Can they taunt you? Did you care about that?
Well, I tried to stay concentrated there again because, you know, when I was in the rink, I could lose it very, very quickly.
Right.
You know, so that I had to be careful and concentrate and not to lose it.
What's the one way I can get under an opposing team's skin if they're in the penalty box and I'm sitting next to the box? Put my butthole on the thing? I don't want to do, although sometimes you don't want to do that because Ty Domi type guys, which you don't really see anymore, will climb out into the stands to beat you up.
Well, you know, you can't climb to the stands. You know, once in the playoffs against Colorado, you know, they had those pom-poms night, you know, those white things. You know, when I got out, I got expelled from the game. I got 10 minutes, so I left the ice, and everybody started throwing those pom-poms at me. So I turned around, and I went to the rail. I didn't touch anybody, but I went to the rail. You know, like, what are you guys doing? Then everybody came. The cops came. They took me out. And I had a phone call with the commissioner the next day. He goes, Chico, you're lucky you didn't touch anybody because the fans are the most important people in the game today.
Yeah.
I said, but I know, but what did you do to stop that from getting hit?
Yeah.
So after that, we got that, you know, that big cover
that goes over it. Yeah.
Because back then, we didn't have any covers.
Right.
They used to throw stuff at us. The last game with the Minnesota North Stars before we were leaving to Dallas, I mean, people were throwing bottles.
Oh, Jesus.
I mean, bottles onto the ice. You know, I remember getting like a bottle of vodka right in front of me.
Really?
Just exploded in front of me.
See,
it's ridiculous.
I like a rivalry. Like, I think it's fun. To boo the other team when they come out, if it's a light, boo, bad team. But I like that both the teams that have if the Canadian teams there and they play the Canadian national anthem, you better respect both countries' national anthems.
Yeah,
you don't throw anything at the players. You can boo them all you want. And I don't mind when opposing teams' fans are in the stands. It would be queer if it was just all Lightning fans and you'd have nobody to go against, you know?
Exactly.
So I don't mind it, but you can't cross the line there. And unless you get a guy like Marchand who's licking people's faces and stuff, then he deserves a smack every once in a while.
Of course he does. He deserves to be suspended also.
Yeah.
You can't do that.
He's a weirdo. He's a weird dude.
You know, you punch someone in the face if you want, because that's tolerated by the NHL. But to lick somebody in the face?
Yeah. No, come on, an ugly guy like that. Like, if a nice, handsome guy licks you in the face, it's okay.
Well,
but
that wouldn't have happened to me, because he could have reached me anyway.
That's true. That's true. All right, so tell me now, you do TV, you do radio, everything's so successful for you. What in the world? Like, I've known you for a long time, and you've always been a smart guy, but never in the world were you like, one day I'm going to go into politics. And the next thing you know, I see you're running for some sort of office. We don't understand how your weird Canadian government works.
Yeah, well, we're like the British. We're like the British government, the way they do it there. So we have, well, actually, I was doing good on TV, doing good on the radio. I was a morning man also. But since I was 33 years old, Mike, every time there was an election,
yeah,
they used to approach me on the federal and provincial side.
So
every time.
You're a liberal.
Yeah, I'm a liberal, yeah.
So they would go to you there, side, or it didn't matter? Both sides?
Every side.
Okay.
I mean, we have more than two sides in Canada. Oh, here you got the Republicans and Democrats.
That's
but
it.
Us, we have like four different parties.
And you know? I know, because I drove through and I could see all the signs. I went through during election. There were a lot of different parties.
Yeah.
And it seems like every time I go to Canada, there's an election.
Well, department now we have in Quebec, we have four parties.
Okay.
Which is good because, I mean, it creates debates and, you know, the different ideas. And
what are the, so here we have conservatives and liberals.
Yeah.
What are the, is there a moderate?
We have liberals,
parties.
Yeah, we have more nationalist party.
Okay.
We have one, it's more of environmental party.
Yeah, yeah.
Then we have the Parti Québécois, which they want to separate from Canada.
Oh.
So that's
to get Montreal to
but
separate.
But that's the opposite of the liberals. You know? Okay. We're happy Quebecers in our country.
Okay. So So they approach you a bunch of times.
So they approach
Why
every
you?
Time.
Because you're famous as a hockey player? Or because they believe you know?
No, because I took positions. I took positions with education, with drugs, with kids. You know, I put in a lot of policies. You know, with the hockey world and
right.
you know sports. So they said that guy's got.
You got leader potential.
Exactly. Yeah. I mean, I was good in debates also. So he said, well, he's good in communication. He's on TV and, you know, he does stuff.
Devastatingly handsome.
Well, he doesn't let go when he has something in his head. So that kind of people like that.
Yeah.
And finally, it was last year in 2018. You know, it was what 2022, 2018. They called me again. You know, said, Rico, we'd like to meet you. And it was the right timing because after a show, you know, I used to from 6 to 10 in the morning, like you. And
it's just so funny because I would watch you online doing your show live, and I'd be like, hey, there's Chico. And then all of a sudden, the mic would go on. I have no idea what you're saying. Like, sounds like he's doing great.
Yeah, that was French. So I'd be on my patio outside, you know, by the pool at 10:45, and I would feel useless.
Yeah.
I would feel useless.
You're too young of a guy and too smart of a guy to be retired.
I said, I love the show. I love what I do in the morning, but what do I do now? So I felt useless, and that came about again. So I said, you know what? This is the time.
Yeah.
At 48 years old, I'll be 50 in April. So I said, that's the time. If you want to do something, leave a mark, do something. So that's why I jumped, and I got elected.
I was just saying, who are you going up against? A bunch of people, one person?
Yeah, a bunch of people.
Yeah.
Bunch of people.
And be honest, how much of your winning had to do with your fame?
Not really.
Okay.
You know, I'm not going to take all the credit.
I think it works against you. I'm not going to vote for some dumb hockey player.
Well, that's what happened, too.
Right.
So, hockey player, what does he know about, you know, the our world and politics? And that played against me. They played all these, you know, it is in politics. They try to dig for bad stuff, you know. So
at first, call me. I'll sell you out.
Not a chance. So when I decided to go, you know, you got to think about that. Okay, what did I do? Somebody's gonna come up, or you know. Then after a while, I said, no, you know, I've been clean, and you know, I pay my bills. I have no debts. You know, I'm all this, and I did everything
Nothing
right.
To hide.
So and I'm sure they dug.
Yeah.
They didn't find anything, so that's why.
If they would offer me money, I would have said he mouth kissed me all the time.
What's wrong with two guys kissing? Is something wrong with that?
A little forceful in your hold.
Oh, okay.
So you get elected, And did you know at a certain point you were probably going to win? Did they poll that you're going to win, or you don't really?
I got announced winner about 40 minutes after the poll ended.
Okay,
I knew right away when they opened the boxes.
And that must be a great feeling.
It was a great feeling.
New chapter in your life.
It was a great feeling because the way I came in to my writing and everything, my association, you know, everybody left.
Oh, so
everybody left.
It was a whole rebuild
because they didn't agree with me coming.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they didn't agree with me coming because of all that. What does he know? He's a hockey player, and he fights all the time. But they didn't see the person behind the hockey player.
Right.
You know, and that to prove them wrong, and I did, and I went around and debate and, you know, met the people for 30, 40 days.
Yeah. And, yeah, I see you on Facebook all the time. You're super
active. Yeah, I won their hearts, and there you go, you know. So then I built a new association, and
now how long can you do this?
Now they love me.
How long are you in office for?
Forever.
Well, what's the next
election? Oh, it's 4 years. Every 4 years, yeah.
So we're coming up on it, or
no, to 2022.
Okay, so, you need me to come lead your campaign?
But depends what you want
to
do.
I mean, I'm just saying, if you need me to speak in your behalf, here to help me win the election is my chubby American friend. Should go over very well.
From Florida, yeah, but you're a Trump supporter, so I don't know if that would work.
Oh, I support the president of the United States.
That's you've changed now?
No, I support our president.
Oh, it's funny. You guys changed. I have a few buddies in Florida that, you know, are big, big Trump supporters. And after 3 years, well, you know,
this and that. I'm not wavering in my... Here's my thing. I did not want to vote for Hillary, so I voted for Trump.
Okay.
I'm not mad at Trump. He does some dumb stuff, but I think he's done all right. And I think there's no doubt in my mind he's going to win again. This is going to be an impeached president who runs for election and wins again.
Really?
Absolutely.
All right. We'll hold you on that. Yeah. See what happens.
Listen, let me tell you something. You had a lot of Canadians get shot down on that Ukrainian plane.
Yeah.
You should call your boy Trudeau and be like, hey, we should be a little angry.
But he wasn't happy. He wasn't happy about that.
But just sitting at home and crying about it isn't going to make it do anything.
No, I know.
He falls up a little bit.
I know he cries a lot.
Yeah.
I mean, he's a sensitive man. Come on, man.
You could be sensitive, but when it comes on to... Yeah. Is he,
he's going to make his brown face paint.
Now, I will tell you, I don't think that that's wrong.
You know what? I'm not going to go into the brown face thing, but, I mean... If you go to a Halloween party, you know, you know, if I go back to all my my Halloween costumes, man, I might have done something stupid there that maybe somebody would have pissed off today.
But it was a different time. Yeah, it's totally a different time.
But was it stupid, or were you trying to look like Muhammad Ali, or were you trying to look like a, you know, you come in there with some with big lips carrying a watermelon, you're a horrible person.
Yeah.
You go in there with brown. Singers, you're trying to play some sort of Middle Eastern guy, that just means you're trying to dress like the character.
Well,
that's odd.
I think you have to judge people on what they're doing today.
I'm with you on that.
With it, or maybe last or 2 years, but to go back 20 years and say, look what he does and what he thinks about it.
You go back 20 years and you're wearing a Klan hood, that's still bad. Yeah. You go back 20 years and you wear it and different. You're just trying to look like Don King. That's not bad. You know what I mean? I'm for Trudeau on that.
Well, you know, just don't paint your face.
No, not without
a mask on.
Not anymore,
I'm afraid. I gave up Halloween just because I'm afraid of Owen. You know what I mean? Enrico Chicone is here. So what is the official title?
M&A.
M&A, which
MP,
is
it's member of parliament. Uh-huh. M&A because the parliament, you know, we have a parliament in Quebec and one in Canada. That's the federal parliament. And in Quebec, we have a parliament also, but it's called National Assembly.
Okay.
So I'm a member of the National Assembly.
And how much does that pay? Does that pay well?
No,
I didn't think so. No,
it doesn't.
Not from millions of dollars in hockey.
I can't say no because people that don't make our money will say, look at this guy talking. But, I mean, we're paid okay.
Doing it for the money.
What I'm saying. Yeah. For the hours that we put.
Right.
You know, it's not like we're not making millions of dollars.
Right. You know? Okay, I get you.
And we don't get paybacks. You know, people say politicians, they get, you know, just kickback. That's not
true. You mean like American?
Are you nuts? We don't do that. We don't do that. So, but we do it for, we're not doing it for the money. We do it because we believe we can change something.
And will you keep doing this?
I love it. You know, I deposit a bill You know, it's called Bill 196. It's on concussions, just to keep track of all the concussions with the kids. And when you go into sports, well, the coach, your organization, they can see how many concussions that you had.
That's great.
So that's what I deposited last April, and now the minister has to call it. You know, minister.
Who argues against something like that? Like, why would you not?
The government right now is there's a lot of partisanship.
Oh man,
a lot of partisanship. Because it's the first time in the history of the parliament there's a ex-NHL player in this seat, you know, because I take care of sports, leisures, and healthy living.
Right.
And my opposite, she's a two-time Olympic medalist.
Oh, okay.
Also, so it's the first time in history that two high athletes are in the same, you know, dossier, and we can't even work together. That's a shame. That's a shame.
Politics is so frustrating.
Yeah,
you want to get stuff done and you can't. You're trying to do. Most people that get into it with good intentions.
But the thing is, the problem, the things I don't like is that when there's an issue, you know, back then in hockey, 30 seconds, everything's over.
Right.
But here, it just drags on. So that's.
Well, I'm proud of you. I'm proud that you are doing so well, man. I think it's great. You are not on my list of guys I thought would go on to politics.
I don't have the.
You have the look, but I would. If you would have said to me, "Hey, I'm doing acting in Canada now, and I'm starring in a new role. I play the neighbor who's a former hockey player."
I did some little roles like that.
You did, really?
Oh yeah, I did some stuff.
That's great.
Yeah. Cameos.
Now look at you.
Well, I'm just a regular person and just try to help people. That's all.
All good.
That's all, man.
Now when I go to the airport, it's so...
The airport is on my my territory.
Oh, you know, it is?
Yeah, it is. It's mine. The first time, it's funny because the first time I got elected, I went out of the country for about a week or so. When I came back, they checked my bags.
Oh,
the first time I ever get checked in my life, because I got Nexus, I got, you know, a global entry, I got all that, you know. And the first time I come back to my airport in my county, in my riding, and they pulled me over.
Yeah.
You know, then they pulled me over, then I got in there to, and the guys were opening my, they looked at me and go, "Oh my God, what are you doing here?" I said, "Well, I don't know, you sent me over here, so you got... Take your stuff and get out of here."
That's so funny. That's like I always.
It's okay. They're doing their job.
Leroy Selman, if he is allowed to speed on the Selman Expressway, and he was like, "Not only am I allowed to speed, I just got a ticket last week." I go, "How? Who has the balls to give you a ticket on an expressway that's named after you? That's ridiculous."
But that's the other thing. We got to be more extra careful, because somebody will take a picture of you. They will, and even if it's not true, you know, just a rumor, you're screwed, man.
Yeah, that's enough. That's all you need these days.
Yeah.
Well, Enrico Chicone, one of the Tampa Bay Lightning fan favorites. What do they do with the alumni? You guys got any? I know that was last year they did some stuff.
Last year they did the 25th year anniversary.
I would be happy to go to an old timers game, like maybe one period before a Lightning game on a Saturday.
Well, they can do that. They do games here sometimes.
Yeah.
Well, we did it in Montreal, Canadians. We do it all the time.
Right.
I used to go around the province with them. But here, you know, every time I come here, you know, just shout out to Rachel, you know, Kilman, and Bill Wickett. They always take care of the alumni. They're great people. And
good.
You know, they take care of their own. So
I went to that game where they brought out all the players that from the teams, all the past players. It was great to see all those guys.
Yeah, it's fun.
And I went to the Fan Fest one year and run into guys you forget about. Paul Isabard.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, oh, I remember that. Because that was, you know, this is all new to me, hockey, when I first got here. It's amazing. Yeah. Well, dude, I'm glad things are going so well.
Thanks for 25 years of friendship, buddy.
Yeah, thank you.
You know, and because of you now, my son calls me douchebag. You know that, eh?
Your son
tell the story.
Was asking if guys who wear V-neck T-shirts, he didn't like them. He said, "You look like a douchebag." And Chico was wearing a V-neck T-shirt. He says he didn't like it. And his English at the time was half and half, you know. And he's like, "You look like a douchebag." And that was it. From now on, I'm like,
because every time, like when it's his birthday on Facebook, or because my father, my son's a fireman now. So when he got, you know, into the fireman school, he goes, "Hey, congratulations, douchebag." So they call each other douchebag.
Well, it's French,
but he calls me douchebag. And I say, "Be careful, son, because douchebag will get you $50,000 that I pay for your school, the $20,000. He wants that money back.
As a politician, you can't punch him in the mouth. I could still hit my kid.
You can't do that. No.
Although my kid's bigger than me now. We took the picture.
Oh, it's funny.
The 5-year picture we took with our kids at dinner, the difference is unbelievable.
I know.
How those kids grew.
Especially
so
your
fast.
Kids, because your kids were younger.
Yeah.
They're men now.
I have a dream that you know, my son plays hockey, and my dream is not for him to make in the NHL. My dream is for Jake to make in the NHL, Pete's son. And then Jake, he's so good, but he's getting his ass kicked. And they say, we need to call Joey in here. And they bring Joey back in, and he brings the goon back to hockey. And then my son will just be the, like now when he plays, you know, he's not Gretzky on the ice. He's an okay player, but I call him the disruptor. Because try to get past him with a puck and see if he doesn't just smash it out of your hand.
It's all about character, man.
That's it.
Character and heart.
If Jake could be the first round pick, and then my son go as like an 18th round disruptor, we'll be very happy with that.
We need everybody.
The problem is though is that Pete will probably get us in trouble somehow.
Oh yeah.
Really?
Oh yeah.
Like Pete and I will go to all the games together, and I'll find out Pete's probably betting on the team to lose. Uh-huh.
You wouldn't do that,
Pete. To win?
To win? You would buy the referees? No, you
not
wouldn't
the referees.
Do that.
But he couldn't buy his son either. He has to buy my son.
Uh-huh.
Jake's like, I would never do that, Dad. And my son's like, what's it called? What are I getting for it? $5,000. Yeah, all right. I'll dive. I'll do it. I'm just saying. It's a movie. It's coming out.
All right.
We're going out. Chico, thank you.
Am I going to have a role? Give me a little role.
Yeah.
Cameo role or something.
By the time that movie comes out, you're going to be the general manager.
Okay, that's good.
Yeah.
Take that.
And too much gray to be anything else.
Hey, I love you, man.
Yeah, love you too, buddy.
Thanks for being nice to me.
Did you hear that? Chico, you're one of the only guests to ever say I love you that I responded naturally to. Normally, it makes me very uncomfortable.
25 years, man.
No, yeah. I know, but I didn't. I said it, and I didn't even realize I said it.
Really?
Most times, people are like, I love you, and I'm like, go get him. Or I look at Spanish, and Spanish will say it for me.
That's true love.
Yeah.
It's nice to see he has a heart.
See that?
Yeah. I do.
Showed you.
Yeah, I told you.
Nice, yeah.
Chico, thank you,
thanks,
man.
Buddy. Thanks,
take a quick break.
Thank
it's
you.
The Mike Calta Show.
You're listening to the Mike Calta Show.